Shalom and welcome to the Middle East Report. In this program today, we'll be marking Israel's 72nd birthday, in Hebrew known as Yom Ha’atzmaut, and I will be joined by Israel's spokesman from the embassy in London. Warm welcome to the programme, and today we have a special guest. We have an Israeli diplomat who is the spokesman on behalf of the Israeli embassy in London, Ohad Zemet. Warm welcome to the programme.
Thank you for having me.
Pleasure. Ohad, can you share with us something about your kind of Jewish background growing up in Israel in the 80s and 90s?
So my family has been in Israel for seven generations.
Wow.
From Jerusalem and from my grandmother's side. I grew up in the 80s in Israel, which was a normal upbringing, I think, like here in the UK. I remember, I think in the 90s, there was an issue with growing peace and hope between Israelis and Palestinians, mass immigrations, also a lot of terrorist attacks in Israel in the 90s. These were my upbringing, but I can say that people in the UK and in Israel have quite a similar life.
Very much so. So we're here to mark Israel's 72nd anniversary as a nation reborn. Can you share what it's like to actually be a representative on behalf of the Israeli government, knowing, for example, that this is something that your ancestors longed for, the re-establishment of the modern state of Israel after being in exile for over 2,000 years?
So, in my family, it's always been public service, and Zionism was always one of the core values. My grandparents, all of them were in Israel before the country was born. One of them was serving even in the British military. Other one was hanging posters for the resistance against the British. And they all, you know, they all came from Eastern Europe, and they all longed for a country to be for the Jewish people. And this is the miracle of the state of Israel, after 2,000 of years of people. You know, who would imagine that Israel will be formed again?
What is it like to be a diplomat to represent the Israeli government to various countries throughout the world and be part of the Israeli Foreign Ministry?
So it's a great honor. It's a great privilege to be an Israeli diplomat. I believe when you believe in the cause of the state of Israel, it's very easy. And I believe Israeli diplomats and being a diplomat, it has a lot of independence, provide you with a lot of room for proactive initiatives to initiate things in order to promote the state of Israel. And it's a great honor.
Excellent. Your last posting was to Egypt. And last year marked the 40th anniversary of the historic signing of the Camp David Accords between Israel and Egypt, once sworn enemies, now partners, so-called partners for peace in the Middle East. Can you share and talk about your posting to Cairo and what was that like and what were the challenges being an Israeli diplomat in the heart of the Egyptian?
Being a diplomat in Egypt was a great privilege. My father fought a war against Egypt, and he came to Egypt to visit his son. So this by itself, it's a great thing to do. You are in Cairo, so you are the only, let's say, Israeli or Israeli agency in Cairo, and your job is to advance peace. So you meet Egyptians that may be, you know, suspicion, maybe has, you know, prejudice about Israel, what they hear in the media in Arabic. And you meet them and you try to build bridges. My job there was to be in charge of economy, so to bring economic, to make economic ties. And I try to get, to find, to matchmake basically, to find Israelis that wants to do business in Egypt, and Egyptian wants to do business in Israel, because the potential for the relations is so huge. And in the time I was there, we had there was an agreement that was signed to export gas from Israel to Egypt, and this is unique, and this is a deal that you know, brought both countries together, and it's not only an economic issue, but also an issue of bringing countries together in the region. And we saw the time that I was there, we saw Egypt forming a new international body called the East Mediterranean Gas Forum, which include Israel, the Palestinians, Jordan, Cyprus, and Greece. So this was the first organization, international forum that was established by a Middle Eastern country, includes Israel. And you can see that more and more people understand that while Israel, although we have peace with Egypt, a lot of people in Egypt saw Israel as a competitor, a challenger, a threat. And we see people in Egypt and people across the region understand that Israel is their ally. Israel is a force for good. And there is a huge potential for cooperation, also political cooperation, security-wise, but also economically. And the challenges that the Middle East is facing, Israel is an integral part of the Middle East, and Israel faced many of the challenges. We're talking about shortage of water, desertification, and Israel as a country without any natural resources coped with these challenges and can share its experience. I can give you an example. In Israel, in Egypt, there is we had Israeli experts right through the 80s and the 90s that went into Egypt and shared their experience in growing all kinds of agriculture products. And the strawberries now people buy in Tesco or in other supermarkets that they buy from Egypt, are a lot of them are from because of Israeli share knowledge, and also citrus and other issues. And this is, you know, it brings people together, because people who were educated on seeing Israel as their enemy, and suddenly they meet Israelis. They see them as friends, as colleagues, as business partners. Their mindset is changed, and Israel always been trying to reach out for its neighbors, trying to advocate for peace, extend to make more economic and general ties. And this is exactly what we did in Egypt, and I was very happy to be part of it.
Excellent. So one last question on Egypt, and how has General Sisi made life better for ordinary Egyptians, and certainly cooperating far more with Israel, as you discussed there, on the economic level, but also on the political level and the security level as well?
So Egypt, from 2011, Egypt had revolution, and Mubarak was ousted, and Egypt entered into a phase of turmoil. And it's not only in Egypt. We see this trend all around the Middle East. We see that the so-called Arab Spring changed into a a turmoil that saw a rise of radicalism, rise of groups that advocated for values of extreme values against the West, against Israel, and we saw that Egypt economically suffered from this period of upheaval, and I believe Egypt now is undergoing a phase of more stability, because people understand that stability, this is a way forward for them, because without stability there is no economic progress, there is no, you cannot achieve even political, more political rights, and I believe Egypt now is in a good phase of stability. We hope Israel, as Egypt's neighbor, hope Israel will prosper. And this was one of our main messages in Egypt, is that Israel's interest is to make Egypt much more developed economically and in all fields, and therefore we are here to help because we are neighbors, and neighbors want their neighbors to be better. And I hope Egypt is now on a good path.
Excellent. So you're now posted to London, which is great. And I had the pleasure of meeting you in the office a few weeks ago. Can you share with us what your role entails as the spokesman on behalf of the Israeli Embassy in London?
So, Israeli Embassy in London, and London being such a media hub with a lot of international media outlets and British media outlets located here, the Israeli government designated a specific diplomat to engage with the media, to be proactive, and we have it in other embassy. And I see my role as more a focal point to provide information, to provide context, and to try to help British media to know the full story, because we believe that if people knows the real truth about Israel and the whole context, then it's much better. People will be more informed, and they will understand Israel's dilemmas, what is, you know, Israeli interest, and what we do, what you know, the things that the actions that the Israeli government is doing. And we also try to promote and to show the other side of Israel. So, and I think it's happening. I'm working and I'm going to newsrooms. I speak with tech editors, with science journalists, and they're all very much interested in Israeli high-tech industry, in stories coming from Israel, Israel startups, because Israel is a powerhouse for innovations. And you know, if a few years ago, you would imagine people only think about Israel in terms of conflict and maybe in terms of Holy Land or this kind of aspects. Now people see Israel as a place for inventions, and journalists wants to hear these stories, and also wants to hear stories about the fabric of the society, about you know, how the integration in Israel and the relation between minorities. Also stories about environment. Israel is the only, I think it's the only country that in since its creation, now there are more trees than have been in 1948. So people wants to know about all this amazing things happening in Israel.
Amazing. And can you share with us your impressions of the British media? Because it's very much a mixed bag. Because we do have some tabloids, we do have some broadsheets that are very supportive of Israel. But the main problem when it comes to the UK media is usually with the big broadcasters.
The British media, as I said, is very influential and very important. And I think the journalists that I meet are very intelligent, very smart, very knowledgeable. And what we try to do, as I said, is to provide information and to speak with them. And of course, coverage of Israel is improportional in relation to the size of Israel. And I think that it's the role of the British media and the Western media in general is to highlight not only the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, which is important, but also other places that needs media attention. Maybe it's not so easy to report from. It's very easy to report from Israel because there is freedom of speech and you can say whatever you want, but it's very hard to report from countries like Syria.
Absolutely.
It's very difficult to report from Iran, and it's important to say it. And also, as I said, I think the British media is interested in other stories from Israel. And this is where we step in.
And Ahad, it will soon be Yom Ha’atzmaut, which is known as Israel's Independence Day, and Israel will be celebrating her 72nd anniversary as a nation reborn. Why is Yom Ha’atzmaut, and looking at some of the incredible achievements that Israel's been able to achieve over the past 72 years, what stands out for you?
Yom Ha’atzmaut, first of all, I believe it's a miracle that the state of Israel exists. The Jewish people was scattered throughout the world, not only Europe, the Middle East. There is much more people in Israel from Middle Eastern origin than European, and And it's a miracle that the state, you know, people gathered from all around the world, and now they are in Israel, people that were persecuted. This is a miracle by itself. And I think the main achievement of the state of Israel, this is my personal view, is the issue of integration and education. These are the two main issues. In the first two years of the state of Israel, Israel doubled its population, needed to integrate people from all different parts of the world with different cultures, different languages, different educational expertise and levels. And the countries and the country integrate them without any resources in the 50s. We're talking about the 50s. And in one generation, you know, provided education to those people. And now we are in a stage that Israel is one of the most highly educated country in the world, with the main economic export, let's say, is human capital. And because we don't have any natural resources, so human capital, this is the main resource we have. Therefore, investment in education and the ability of the state to integrate all these people who came from abroad, I believe, the main achievement of the state of Israel, against all the odds, against, you know, countries around it that tries to, you know, to attack Israel, hostile countries. Against all the odds, Israel managed to flourish.
Excellent. So if you ever wondered what Yom Ha'atzmaut is, let's have a look at this.
David Ben-Gurion declared an independent state of Israel on May 14, 1948, and a new chapter of Jewish history began. The British had controlled Palestine under the British Mandate, but that expired at midnight, and so the early Zionists declared a new nation. Some of them had lived in the land for generations, and some were new arrivals from Nazi Europe. For a couple of years, May 14th was a day for mourning lost soldiers. Then in 1951, Israel decided to split the day into two parts, Yom HaZikaron, Remembrance Day, and Yom Ha'atzmaut, Independence Day. It is celebrated on the 5th of Iyar, or one of the days right around it. In 1953, Yom HaShoah, Holocaust Remembrance Day, was also added to this period, happening 8 days earlier. Yom HaZikaron begins at night with a minute-long siren where the whole country stops and stands in silence. Another siren the next morning kicks off the official memorial ceremonies, as well as private ones where people remember their loved ones. As night falls, the memorial mood shifts quickly as Israelis move into party mode and Yom Ha'atzmaut begins, starting with a formal state torch lighting ceremony on Mount Herzl in Jerusalem, to fireworks over Rabin Square in Tel Aviv, to street parties everywhere. As the night goes on, the party gets more and more lively, of course. And the next day, while possibly nursing an Arak hangover, is all about a barbecue on the beach or at the park with absolutely everyone else. Around the world, Jewish communities join in solidarity with those in Israel by wearing blue and white to celebrate the Israeli flag, eating classic foods like hummus, falafel, watermelon feta kebabs, and of course, bamba. Folk dancing is a fun old school tradition, and lots of communities host big parties featuring Israeli rock bands, artists, and nonprofits. In synagogues, some communities say the Psalms of Praise called Hallel, or the Prayer for Miracles, Ala Nisim. Why? Because, for some Jews, the founding of the state was a religious historical event, the fulfillment of a biblical promise to Abraham and Sarah that the land they walked would one day be home to their children's children. There's some difference here about who says what, but the basic idea for these religious Zionists is that Yom Ha'atzmaut is a modern holy day. Not so for secular Zionists who remember and celebrate, but without the religious overtones. Some Jews differ very strongly and see the founding of the state as heresy. These Haredim, or ultra-Orthodox Jews, say that the promise to Abraham and Sarah was to be fulfilled by God, not by people. They don't mark the founding of the state, even if they choose to live there. Finally, about 20% of the state is not Jewish at all. They are Muslim, they are Christian, they are Druzi, or they are foreign students and workers of different religions. They see the day differently. Some feel, despite their religious difference, a patriotism and respect for the Holy Land as a Jewish and democratic state. Others mark the day with protests and memorials on behalf of the Arabs who fell in battles or fled the land in 1948. Taken together, Yom HaShoah, Yom HaZikaron, and Yom Ha'atzmaut constitute a week that is sometimes called the Israeli High Holidays. Danielle Hartman writes, "The sadness of Yom HaZikaron does not give new meaning to Yom Ha'atzmaut. Rather, it gives it gravitas. It reminds us of the price we paid and, as a result, the care, responsibility, and duty we have to build a great country and to live and to give our lives special meaning." Thank you.
if you've ever been in Israel for Yom Ha’atzmaut, it's something to behold. You'll never see so many Israeli flags flying, so many barbecues and fireworks. It's a great celebration. Marking Israel's 72nd anniversary as a state, we know that as soon as the nation of Israel was declared on the 14th of May 1948, Israel was attacked by five Arab armies, then followed by another war against Egypt and the Suez Crisis of 56, then the Six-Day War, and then the Yom Kippur War, and of course the Lebanon War as well. So Israel had to be born in a very dangerous region, and military plays a huge part in Israel's defense, but also in its outlook and its culture. What are the odds of Israel actually overcoming some of these major challenges? Because knowing that all it takes is for one military defeat of Israel, and that's it, Israel as a nation is no longer there. So how has Israel as a nation be able to thrive under those extremely difficult circumstances?
So throughout the years, as you said, Israel endured many challenges. And I think it's the, as I said, the human capital, people. It's only about people trying, sticking together in very tough circumstances and working on the, I think the main notion of the country is self-help. So Israel was created for Jews to have place of their own that they can defend themselves. So we never asked for troops to be sent to Israel. We developed a military industry in order to provide for ourselves, to provide innovations that can help us. And the main challenge currently, I believe, is Iran and the issue of radicalism. We see with the Hamas in Gaza, we see Hezbollah, which is an Iranian proxy in Lebanon. We see these extreme people who wants to annihilate the state of Israel. We see them pose a challenge to Israel, but I can assure you that we do whatever we can to overcome it. But and like you said, it takes only one defeat. The width of the state of Israel in a certain places was until 67 was only 12 kilometers, which is nothing. People sometimes think about Israel as something big. Israel is very small, so therefore very fragile. And this is why people in Israel are very much wants to maintain it, because it's so fragile, so it's so important to keep it strong.
Absolutely. So looking at the kind of major threats, what are the major threats and challenges facing Israel in the Middle East, namely the Islamic Republic of Iran for its state sponsorship of international terrorism, its support for Hezbollah and Hamas, but also then as well their pursuit of nuclear missiles technology?
As you mentioned, Iran is the major threat and the major challenge, not only to Israel. It's very interesting to see that that Iran is a challenge, first of all, for the international community, but also regionally. You see countries that that never spoke to Israel, and they face this challenge of Iran trying to use proxies to fight, to destabilize the region. We see it in Iraq. We see the attack of the American embassy in Iraq. We see it in Yemen. We see it in Lebanon, of course, and in Iraq. And Iran actions in the regions are a threat to stability. Also, the issue of nuclear. This is a major threat worldwide. Iran is not stopping, even with the nuclear deal that was signed, that people thought this will put an end to Iranian ambition. We saw it's only like Israel Prime Minister said all over. It's only stopped. It's not stopped. Delayed Iran for a short bit with providing it with a lot of cash, with lifting sanctions. Therefore, really assisting Iran in pursuing its ambitions. And Iran has missiles. Already has missiles that can target Israel, and they declare many times that they think Israel should be wiped off the map. They see America as the big Satan, Israel is a small Satan, and Britain maybe middle-sized Satan. So now they develop missiles that can get to Europe. Why do they do it? Why do they need these kind of missiles? Because Iran is a threat, and we in Israel, and the prime minister stated many times, we want Iran to start acting like a normal country, to stop with these activities. And as long as it's continue with these activities, with pursuing nuclear capabilities, with with regional subversiveness and trying to destabilize the region and developing missiles, as long as we see these activities, Iran the world cannot let Iran continue.
So let's have a look at the threat posed by Iran, also with Hezbollah and in Lebanon.
Israel just exposed details about the precision-guided missile project that Iran is developing with its proxy in Lebanon, Hezbollah. If completed, this program could have enabled Hezbollah to remotely fire missiles to any location in Israel with alarming accuracy. Iran began its attempts to arm its proxy in Lebanon, Hezbollah, with these sophisticated missiles in 2013. First, they attempted to smuggle fully assembled guided missiles via Syria to Lebanon, but the missiles failed to reach their destination. Then Iran shifted its strategy toward assembling precision-guided missiles inside Lebanon. Under the blind eye of the Lebanese government, the Rafik Hariri International Airport, the Beirut port, and the Masnad border crossing all serve as collection points for missile parts transferred by Iran to Hezbollah. In order to assemble these missiles, Hezbollah built facilities in urban areas across Lebanon, including its capital, Beirut. Iran would send its commanders to Lebanon to hold seminars for Hezbollah operatives on how to assemble and operate precision-guided missiles. Overseeing this project in Lebanon is Mohammad Hossein Zadeh Hejazi, a senior commander of the Iranian Quds Force, who went as far as moving to Lebanon with his family. For 2 years, despite various efforts carried out by Israel, Hezbollah furthered their attempts to produce precision-guided missiles. In September 2018, Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu addressed the UN and exposed three precision-guided missile manufacturing facilities embedded in Beirut. The state of Lebanon did not show any resistance to the construction of these sites in the heart of their country, even though it endangered the lives of the Lebanese people and was in clear violation of UN resolutions. Lebanese officials, including the foreign minister, even backed Hezbollah. Over the last few months, Iran expedited its efforts to arm Hezbollah with precision weapons by accelerating the construction of production facilities in Lebanon. Iran's deep involvement in Hezbollah's force buildup threatens the stability of the state of Lebanon and the region as a whole.
And this is a very real threat that Israel faces from the Islamic Republic of Iran. Not only its support for Hamas and Hezbollah, the fact that Iran has over 160,000 to 180,000 rockets in southern Lebanon ready to target Israel is a threat not only to Israel, but also to the region and Europe as well, and particularly their pursuit of nuclear weapons. I want to move on now, Ahad, and talk about the peace process, because sadly, as you know, with the British media, a vast majority of the British media see Israel through the prism of the conflict. And yet we have the US President Trump announced his peace plan a few months ago. What do you think of his peace proposals, and why are the Palestinian Authority completely rejecting this out of hand?
Well, our Prime Minister said that the peace plan is, Israel is willing to negotiate on the basis of the peace plan. Of course, we don't like everything in this peace plan, but the main issue is why the Palestinians are not coming to the table and why they are rejecting again and again any proposal that is put in front of them. We saw it many times in the past, and people need to understand that only through direct negotiations, only through talking, and of course under the auspices of the US, this is the only way that peace was achieved before, and we saw it in Egypt, in the Egyptian case, and this is the only way it could be achieved in the past. And it's very unfortunate that we cannot move forward. And we saw Arab countries that sent their delegates to the launch of the U.S. Of the U.S. peace plan. So you have countries that they understand the importance of the pro- of 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 achieving peace and negotiating, and we hope to see the Palestinian reaching to this conclusion again, because you cannot escape from this conclusion.
So, Ohad, if we look at the kind of regional strategic trends in the Middle East, are the Palestinians finding themselves completely out of step with the rest of the Sunni world, particularly as the Saudis are entering into warmer diplomatic relations with Israel, the Gulf states, Israel's relationship with Egypt, as you mentioned, is getting closer, so is Jordan, and even Sudan is beginning to open up diplomatic relations with Israel. Are they not finding themselves out of step with the rest of the region?
Other countries in the region, and I talked about it, understand that Israel is a positive force, and that relation with Israel is positive for them. And they also understand that the Palestinian cannot hold the entire Arab world hostage because of their rejectionism. And the other countries understand it's for their interest. They need to cooperate with Israel. And if the Palestinian decide to reject every initiative to make peace, they should not be, you know, not do the same. And we see many countries that we see. You talked about the meeting that was Prime Minister declared with Sudan. We see Israeli visitors and athletes competing in the Gulf. We saw the Prime Minister visit to Oman, relation with Chad. People in the Middle East understand that Israel is a positive force, and therefore they need to work with it.
And this is extraordinary, isn't it, considering the complete Arab rejection of Israel only really up until recently shows a real turn in fortunes with relations with the Arab and Muslim world. How much is Israel benefiting from these renewed relations with Israel's former enemies?
So Israel's foreign policy was always to try to reach out for peace, to talk with people, dialogue, always dialogue and not boycotting. Always to talk and to try to work with whoever wants to work with us. So Israel, in terms of ideology, our values are for dialogue and not for, you know, not for war. So I think Israel benefits in this way. And also Israel benefits from any, you know, from the, also economically, also in any kind of cooperation, this is something that benefits. And there is another very interesting trend that's happening in the Middle East, which is countries and people cherish their Jewish heritage. So I don't know if your viewers know about it, but the Middle East was once full of Jews. And only in Egypt there were, before the creation of the State of Israel, 80,000 Jewish people. And all these Jews were forced out due to the creation of Israel. I think it was 800,000 Jews that lived in Iraq and Syria and Egypt, Morocco. My wife's mother is from Morocco, for example, and all other Middle Eastern countries. And now countries are trying to thinking again of why they push the Jewish population out. And you see Sudan, they had one of their ministers calling to Jews to come back. And in Egypt, you see the Egyptian government is rebuilding or renovating synagogues, cleaning up Jewish cemeteries. We saw, I think, in Bahrain, a synagogue was established. In Iraq, you see I can talk about our Facebook page in Arabic. I'm talking about our Ministry of Foreign Affairs Facebook page in Arabic that has 2.5 million followers in Arabic, because people are interested. People are interested in their heritage. People, you know, when I'll give you an example regarding Iraq, when, you know, the country has all these challenges, people think about the time where all the minorities in Iraq lived happily, or not happily always, but, you know, with challenges, but lived in Iraq and contributed to the economy. You had Christians, many Christian minorities that now under stress. You had Jews, you had all kinds of minorities that, and people think that, you know, this was a mistake of driving and pushing minorities out.
So let's have a look now at last year, 2019, and Israel's diplomatic relationship with the art world. And to think only a couple of years ago, that would seem to be the absolute impossible. But as we see, the Arab world is reaching out to Israel, which is changing the whole entire dynamics of the Middle East. I suppose we have to discuss one of the kind of growing concerns for Israel and one of the growing concerns for Jewish community in this country and around the world. And that is with the rise of Jew hatred, reaching levels that we haven't seen since the 1930s and 40s with the onset of the Second World War. What is the nation of Israel doing to reassure Jewish communities across the world facing persecution and facing this rise of Jew hatred we're seeing across the nations?
So fighting anti-Semitism is one of the main, let's say, foreign policy goals of the State of Israel, because the raison d'etre of the State of Israel, the State of Israel was created because of anti-Semitism, because the Jews were persecuted around the world, so to provide a safe haven. So every diplomat, every Israeli diplomat around the world, one of his missions is to try to fight anti-Semitism. And there are other countries with different scales of the problem, and no one would have believed that in the 21st century this will still be an issue. But fortunately, we saw, it was a month ago, we saw a gathering of world leaders in Jerusalem in Holocaust Memorial Days. We saw President Putin, we saw Prince Charles, President Macron there, and we saw Vice President Pence, and all these people represent the international community consensus, which is to fight anti-Semitism. And this is what we promote, and through education, and we hope the situation will be better.
Now, in terms of British-Israeli relations have particularly been flourishing because of Brexit, can you talk to us about the strength and depth of British-Israeli relations currently?
So, British-Israel relations are, I think, in a record high. We saw trade figures on a constant rise. It's more than £9 billion, I think, the trade. And in terms of cooperation, political cooperation and security cooperation, it's on unprecedented level. Only a few months ago, we saw Israeli pilots train with British pilots in RAF Wellington here in the UK. We see government agencies cooperate because we face similar challenges. Israel and the UK, like-minded countries, face issues of extremism, of terrorism, and we work together. And there is much more to do, and I believe the British government and the British people value the relation of Israel and understand. We saw the British government opening a tech hub in Israel, so a place, an organization by the British government that its all aim is to try to reinforce cooperation between and technology companies here in the UK and Israeli ones. So this is the unique one, the only place in the world they decided to open such an institution was in Israel.
And how much would you say in recent years we've seen a huge increase in evangelical Christian support from the nation of Israel and many Christians throughout the world visiting Israel and meeting Israelis and spending their money on as a channel. We do almost an annual tour to Israel to allow our viewers to see the incredible nation that Israel is, with all the wonderful historic sites as well as the modern sites. How important is that Christian support for the nation of Israel?
Israel, as a small country, surrounded by countries who wants to annihilate it, always seeks for support and always valued for support and needed this support. Because without this support, without international support, Israel, has challenges. Therefore, we value every support we can get, and support can be in very different ways. When you meet persons and you educate people about Israel, this by itself is support. It's a support, because not a lot of people knows Israel, knows the challenges, knows the truth about Israel. When you write letters to your local MP about Israel, and when you see Israel is being treated not like any other country and in a unique way and singling out Israel, and you do something about this, this support means a lot to us, and we thank for it.
And for any of our viewers who are very passionate about Israel and the Jewish people, and they visit your homeland, the nation of Israel, is there any way you can advise them where they should go and visit, as an inside view from an Israeli perspective?
As an inside view, please visit the kibbutz that I live in, Ramat Rachel, which is just next to Jerusalem, and it's a great place. There is, I love Jerusalem. I think Jerusalem is a city that has everything, holy places, but also a very great restaurants. Great nightlife, a lot of good university. I studied in a Hebrew university, which had a lot of international students, and it was amazing, the experience they had. So my recommendation is on Jerusalem and my kibbutz, but I can imagine in Tel Aviv you can get good food, nice beaches, depends what you like.
Excellent. So, to mark Israel's 72nd birthday and to mark Yom Ha’atzmaut, let's look at some of those amazing breakthroughs the nation of Israel has achieved over the past 72 years.
Israel is the 100th smallest country on the globe and has about 1/1000th of the world's population. It's only 70 years old, smaller than New Jersey, surrounded by enemies, under constant threat of survival. and possesses few natural resources. And yet, Israel is the only country in history to have revived an unspoken language. Since its founding, Israel has won the second highest number of Nobel Prizes per capita. Although the Jewish people are only 0.2% of the world population, Jews have received 22% of Nobel Prizes, constituting an inexplicable 11,250% above the statistical probability. Israel is the only country that entered the 21st century with a net gain in its number of trees, even more remarkable in an area that's mainly desert. Over 90% of Israeli homes use solar energy for hot water, the highest percentage of any country. Israeli companies are building the largest solar energy production facility in the world. Israel operates the world's largest desalination plant and is the number one country providing usable water from seawater. Israel's scientific research institutions are ranked third in the world and are ranked two in space sciences. Israel leads the world in medical patents and has revolutionized modern medicine. Oramed is changing the diabetes therapeutic paradigm by delivering insulin in a pill. ReWalk's exoskeleton allows paraplegics to walk. Orcam allows blind people to virtually see. Israel has more patents registered in the U.S. than Russia, India, and China combined, who have 300 times Israel's population. Israel's innovations have improved the way we work, print, drive, read, eat, drink, talk, exercise, and even play. Israel is the only liberal democracy in the Middle East, and its third largest party is often the Arab Party. Israel has provided humanitarian aid and rescue services to over 140 countries, even to some that refuse to recognize it, like Syria and Lebanon. Israel is the third most educated country in the world, according to the OECD. Israel has the world's second highest number of new books per capita. Israel has the third highest rate of entrepreneurship among women in the world. And in 1969, Israel elected Golda Meir, the second female head of state in modern history. In proportion to its population, Israel has the largest number of high-tech startup companies in the world. In absolute numbers, Israel has more startups than any other country except the US and China. Israel is the only country whose indigenous population returned to its native land after 2,000 years of forced exile. There are 26 official Muslim states in the world and 18 official Christian states, but there is only one Jewish state. Israel, a small place making a big difference.
And that is just a reminder to us all about how special the nation of Israel is and how God is blessing the land of Israel. I have to ask you, why is Israel so important to you? I know that you're an Israeli, so of course it's important, but why is it so important and how will you be celebrating Yom Ha'atzmaut?
Yom Ha'atzmaut is so important because of the miracle of Israel is, and I can say from my family experience, you know, I have a grandparent fought in the Atzmaut War, the War of Independence, it was with great difficulties, and my father, you know, they fought other wars and they fought for this country, and therefore it means a lot when a lot of people really gave their lives for us being here and for me being a diplomat and representing Israel and for the Jewish people to have a state of their own. So it's not something very easy to think about, or something obvious. You know, a lot of people dedicated their life for this.
Ahad, I thank you so much for being my guest today on the Middle East Report, and I just want to reach out that hand of friendship to just let you know that the Christians in the UK are backing Israel, they're backing the Jewish people, and we'll fight your cause. So thank you.
Thank you.
And I just want to thank you for watching today's program as we look back at the 72 years of Israel being a nation reborn. And this has to be a miracle. Not only is Israel back in a land, but she is thriving and flourishing. So it's important that we celebrate the nation of Israel and do by all means join in with Israel's celebration as Israel celebrates Yom Ha'atzmaut. So I want to thank you for watching today's Middle East Report. Thank you.
Tam for